we are establishing a National Commissioner for Defence and Veteran Suicide Prevention, and they'll be empowered with Royal Commissioner-like authorities.
This is not a one-off thing that will give a report in 18 months or 2 years. This is something that will be rolling, concurrent and ongoing.
The only acceptable number of deaths from suicide is zero.
He was just such a lovely soul. He was a beautiful person. Daniel was in the army for about 2.5 years. He felt incredibly isolated and didn't feel particularly supported. He also had feelings of, you know, being bullied and ostracised and just not being part of what he desperately wanted to be part of. He suffered in silence, as many of them do. They're taking healthy, young, fit young men and women and spitting them out, damaged and suicidal.
Mothers have buried too many of their loved ones. We have buried too many of our brothers and sisters, and this is a step forward in being a part of the solution.
He lived for his army brothers.
He was extremely different when he came home. He changed.
He was extremely traumatised by what he saw over there.
Little things would come out, and the little things that we heard frightened us.
We've been struggling every day since his passing. It's a struggle to watch Mum just keep going. Our family will never be the same. Never.
It won't bring their sons and daughters back, but it will help save lives in the future.
This is the time to get this right, and we really need to get this right for our veterans.
I stand here with tears in my eyes and a heavy heart, knowing that this is the right thing to do.
What we've had to suffer has been extreme, and what my boy has had to suffer should never have happened. He shouldn't have died that way.
Julianne Finney lost her son David, who was a former petty officer in the Navy this time last year, and has been campaigning for an inquiry into veteran suicides ever since. She joins us now. Julianne, I can only imagine there must be, well, mixed emotions, I suppose, about this announcement being so close to the anniversary of David's death. What was your reaction?
Well, I was blindsided when the Prime Minister called me last night, and I didn't know what the phone call was about. So I'm so grateful that that movement has been made in this area, and I was just listening to him. I didn't fully understand it. I still haven't had time to study it in detail, but it's certainly recognition and a step in the right direction.
Julianne, I can't imagine what the last year has been like for you, but what it would have also been like watching your son struggle so much. Can you tell us a bit about David and what was going on for him at the time before he passed away?
Certainly. So David was upbeat, he was articulate and he was smart and he was incredibly funny. And when he was down, he did isolate a lot. The last time I saw him, which was 3 days before he passed away, I could see that he was in a bad way. I spoke to him about visiting the doctor and he promised me he would. It wasn't enough. It was, you know, you wish you'd done more. What more could you have done? It's suicide is terribly difficult to deal with, and we have to learn from past errors. We have to learn going forward, and we have to know that these people are amazing. They've served their country and something in that breaks them, and we need to work out what that is so that we can work better with it.
I understand he was the face of the Defence Force recruiting campaign. Post-service, what kind of support did he get?
Post-service, the help was available for psychiatric help, but he had a 700-kilometre round trip to go to his psychiatrist. There was nothing available in his area, and that's something that he didn't tell us. You know, he always said, I've got a psychiatrist or I'm going to the doctor. A lot of this got found out after death, and as a parent, certainly, you know, if I'd have known he had that issue, we would have paid for a psychiatrist. We would have just bypassed DVA at the time, but it wasn't to be.
What do you think could have helped Julianne? What do you think were some of the things that could come out of this inquiry that could help?
First of all, the discharge process within the ADF. So not just the discharge, I'm not just talking about transition, but I've heard a lot of stories where, I've heard a story of where someone was discharged from an operating table. I don't know if that's true, but I do know that my son was discharged from a hospital bed. From the time they're discharged from the ADF wipes their hands of them. They never contact them again. There is nothing. No employer that I know has that sort of duty of care except for ADF. And a lot of our serving people cannot ask for help when they have health issues or mental health injuries. They can't ask for help because it's the end of their career. So we need to look at what we're doing right back at the core. And that's what worries me about what's happening now, because we do need to investigate it from the core in the ADF throughout their lives.
Well, it sounds like the Commission is going to have their work cut out for them and that you'll be watching, Julianne. So we appreciate very much you helping us understand this issue a little better, and also your time. Thanks so much.
I really appreciate yours. Thank you so much.
And if you find yourself in need of help for any reason, crisis support is available 24/7 through Lifeline on 13 11 14.